Hi there, it's Jenny Fu, and I'm back with some more Kenny tutorials. I apologize that I've been away for a bit, it's just gotten a little bit crazier at work, but I've been itching to get y'all a new video because I enjoy doing this, being inspired by the possibilities with polymer clay, and the opportunity to get to share it with you all. So today's Kenny tutorial is going to be a bit more intermediate, but it will be rewarding to make your own original designs with this process. And if you feel like I'm going too fast, feel free to slow down the video by hitting the cogwheel at the bottom, then playback speed, and then hit your preference for whether or not you want it to go twice the speed, 1.25 or 1.5, or even like 0.75 of the speed. With today's custom kaleidoscope cane, we're starting off by sketching it out. I'm using a simple template of squares consisting of right triangles. However, I'm only going to use the right triangle portion for my cane since I'm going for something simple. It can be a challenge at first knowing where to start, but stick with simple shapes if you're just getting started, like teardrops, swirls, and other lines. You can even use a mirror as you're sketching so that you can see what you're doing. So there are several different design options you can get from your sketch, depending on which direction you piece the parts of the kaleidoscope cane together. So here is one design, which is the one I'm leaning towards using for this video. And here's another cool design option which I really like as well. Step 1. Create solid block. First, you want to create a solid rectangular block using about 60 grams of lighter color clay. I'll put a full list of color clay ratios in the description. I think if y'all have been watching my videos, y'all should be able to create a loaf using a solid color and get to this point. However, I will put a video that goes over how to make loaves in the cards at the top if you need a recap. Once you've made a solid loaf, you want to take a sharp knife and cut off a thin slice from each side of the cube in order to further define the edges. Also, don't worry, I adjusted the amounts of clay to account for the slicing. Keep the scrap clay pieces for later use. Step 2. Create striped cane. Next, we want to create a solid colored bullseye cane with a thick border using 42 grams of the lighter colored clay, which includes the scrap pieces repurposed from step 1. And again, I've gone over bullseye canes several times in past videos, and to try to respect y'all's time, I'll link a video into the cards at the top for those who may be new to bullseye caning that need a step-by-step on that. After you've created your bullseye cane, you want to cut off the excess clay and set that aside. Then take your darker clay and add a border. I recommend a setting of 2. I believe I used 3 and I feel like it got a little thin during the reduction process. Stretch and reduce it to turn it into an oval sort of shape until you get it long enough to divide it into 3 equal pieces. Then compress the 3 pieces together and continue to reduce to make it a bit longer. Then cut that in half and compress again. Step 3. Create stripe component. Take your stripe cane from step 2 and slice off about 1/2 inch. We are going to take this and create our first component for the design. So reduce this piece to elongate it. We're going to then cut this in half and combine again. And then continuously reduce to get it looking like the shape I drew in my sketch. Now, it doesn't have to match the sketch exactly. The sketch is just a guide, and you can make adjustments along the way by relaxing, taking a deep breath, and going with the flow. I also went ahead and added a border around that, and adding a thicker layer of clay just below the component. Now we got our first shape! And next, we're gonna work on these other 3 almond shapes.
Step 4. Create 3 almond shape components.
Next, I'm taking the other striped cane and I'm going to meld the pieces together by sort of rubbing the sides to round out the shape, but also to allow the lines to converge into north and south poles. Hopefully that description makes sense. And I make the top a bit pointier to create sort of a teardrop or almond-y shape. I'll go with almond-y since it kind of reminds me of an almond. Then I cut about 1/4 of it off. I'm just sort of eyeballing it here. And I'm gonna create a smaller almond, so I just reduce it. And next would be to add a thicker line onto the almond. So I take a fairly thick sheet and cut it at an angle to make tacking it on a bit easier along both sides, then stick it on. Next, we're going to create the other two almond components. I cut the almond cane in half, then start reducing. You want to make sure your almonds are at least the height of the solid block you created earlier. And I just keep pinching and forming the sides to get at my desired shape. After that, I'm going to add a thick stroke at the bottom. Just going to speed past that because you don't need to see the same thing twice. I also layer on another stroke just because I want to create some variation in line thickness, which helps create some visual interest. It helps to have small and large shapes and as well as a combination of thick and thin lines in your cane design. It's not always the case depending on what look you want to achieve, but it's a good starting guide for experimentation. Then I finish off by adding a border around everything. And there's your almond. Alright, for the last one, I'm reducing it a bit to get a smaller shape. And I add some thicker borders around it as well. I'm going to speed this up too since y'all don't need to see me explain the same thing twice. And then I'm going to create this thicker light border around it. At this point, I'm using the remaining scraps of lighter colored clay. And I needed a bit more, so I grabbed some scraps left over from cutting off distorted ends of canes. Just make a thick sheet and cut off the sides at an angle, which will help make your life a bit easier. Then I wrap this around my little almond. Then I finish it off by adding a thin border around that as well. Again, these angled cuts makes it easy to connect the pieces at the point at the top. So yeah, let's compare this with our little sketch and see what we got. Alright, looks good. So now I have these guys and a block. Oh, and one more thing, gotta create a little swirl. So I just take a sheet of dark colored clay with an angled edge and set it against a lighter colored clay and just roll it up until I get the desired number of rolls.
Step 5. Assemble components.
Now that we have all our pieces, it's now for the fun stuff. Seeing them come all together into a cohesive cane. So there isn't a right or wrong way to do this. I'm going to use my initial sketch as a starting point with my tiny almond, and I'm gonna stack the swirl on top of that. And so that's why this solid block comes in handy. It's going to be used to fill in the gaps while combining things together. A good rule of thumb is that when in doubt, cut out a triangle. Again, make sure your knife is sharp. I like to periodically wipe it with a paper towel to get rid of residue to reduce blade drag. Starting at a corner, I cut out a triangle which helps me bind these two pieces together. Then I decide I wanted to add a layer to visually separate the two components. So I cut off a slab, if you will, and wedge it in between. So here's my original sketch, and as you can see here, I decided to make a couple of minor tweaks, but the basic idea is still there to help guide me in my next moves, which is attaching a large almond to it. So I just decided to adjust and make the shape a bit more interesting. This is where you get to exercise some creative judgments, which makes things a bit more interesting. So I kind of just look at it and figure out if I need another tiny, medium, or large triangle. Maybe a right triangle, trapezoid, or slab, etc. You get the idea. So I cut out a triangle and make the ends a bit more pointier. Do what you need to do to get it to fit. And there we go.
Now, I'm going to speed forward a bit because I think you get the basic idea at this point, and no cane with this method is going to look the exact same. So there isn't a need to follow me to a T, but if you get the basic idea, you can get going with your own custom designs. Also, I try not to turn this into an hour-long video since I'm not sure if the majority of you guys would want to sit through an hour-long or even 30-minute video. My goal is to try to meet it at a happy medium. Yeah, I'm pretty sure if I took the time to explain each and every piece I'm tacking on, it'd be one very long video. But the point is, I'm tacking on each piece to compile a triangular shape while being careful to avoid trapped air between the layers. And so, towards the end, I kind of made a triangular-ish shape, but in the next stage where I start compressing and molding, I'll force it into the triangular shape I need it to be as a base for the kaleidoscope, so don't worry about absolute perfection. Next, I start reducing the cane because we're going to slice the cane into multiple pieces and then recombine into a full kaleidoscope design. I tend to do this a lot, but in case you're wondering, I added some scrap clay to the ends to help make the reduction process easier and reduce the amount of distorted clay that I have to cut off at the ends. Next, we cut the cane in half, piece them together, and then mold it into a square shape. Square shapes tend to be easier to reduce, so I'm generally happy once I get over to this step. I sort of smush the opposite points inward to force the shape to turn into a square. Along with rolling with an acrylic roller, I gradually get it into more of a square cane. I continue to reduce until I get it longer. And I cut it in half. I like to take my mirrors and take a look at how things are going. So here's one option, which is close to my original design, and here's another, which I also really like. You can do this as well. Make a decision on the cane design you want to go with. Who knows, sometimes you might decide to change directions, but I personally still prefer the original design. Then I reduce so I get enough length to cut in half one more time. After I've reduced it, I then slice the cane again and combine the two halves together to mirror on opposite sides to get my finished and completed kaleidoscope cane design. Thank you for watching till the very end, and good luck with making your own kaleidoscope canes.